primary colors. Let's start with primary colors.
Yeah.
You know what they are, right? Red, blue, primary and gray. Colors,
yeah.
Red, blue, and gray. And the way that they mix together, blue and the yellow, you know, make green.
Make green, right.
And so forth and so on. Well, there's seven overall tones that make up the rainbow. You know, the violet, red, orange.
RGBV.
And then yellow, green, blue, and then and indigo.
Yep.
No, violet makes the rainbow. Indigo. Indigo starts it.
Right.
So anytime you've seen a rainbow, have you ever seen any of those colors missing?
No.
Those colors are always present.
They're always blue, there.
They're
red,
always
orange, there. Yellow, Roy G, green, blue, indigo, violet. Roy G Biv. That's how I remembered it. Roy G Biv.
Well, all of those colors move and reproduce at a different rate.
Yes.
Red will move at a different rate because it's at a different temperature. Different temperatures create great different waste. That waste is part of what gives them propellant in their motion, if you think of it that way. Well, everything, there's three basic colors.
Right.
There's three basic sounds and there's three basic shapes.
Okay.
I thought that there should be a relationship between the light and the color, the sound and the tone and the matter and my shape. My honey, it's just come in. You did great. She's been building a home, a school for our kids. But those three basic things we've always been told that they had no commonality between them.
Right.
So what turns out, the matter of all of those pieces, the matter, its shape, is based in the chemical.
Right.
Yes, I would love to. The light of that shape is based in the higher waveforms. And then the sound is in a lower waveform. So if you combine all of those things, you watch the periodic table go from noble gas to noble gas with seven tones in them. And it's those same colors. And if you keep doubling each of those colors, the key of C, and you start doubling it. It starts at with 2 hertz, then it doubles to 4 hertz, then it doubles to 8, 16, 32, 6,429,
okay,
and on until it reaches the visible spectrum.
Right, but then Terrence, what do you think about 432 hertz and 440? Because after World War II, they changed the frequency to 440, which is not necessarily the frequency of love. And John Lennon tuned his piano to 432, and so did Prince, who tuned all his instruments to 432 hertz.
And why?
Because he believed that that was the frequency of love. That was the frequency of nature. That was the frequency that they knew was the one that connected with nature and where we come from. And for some reason now, it's
but there's a reason why it is the frequency of love. It's the common factor that holds all things together. I was watching this documentary about the secret life of plants and how they are experiencing the same things that we are experiencing.
That's 532 frequency.
So for 432, if what's 432 squared?
Now it's math, and now you lost me.
No, it's the speed of light. 486,400.
Really?
Now you know. Wow, that's that tone that everything can relate to.
And that's the tone that, you know, that everything, like crickets are chirping at, but they say, but that's 532. The frequency thing is confusing.
528. It's how many emotions do you go through with love? There's the Greeks had four different terms for love. They had eros, they had philia, they had agape,
yes,
and they had sturge. And right, each one represented love, but each one was at a different frequency. One was the brotherly love, was the godly love. One was the neighborly love, and the other one was literally the eros, was there.
Right, the eros, the Greek gov, the
everybody
had love. I love you.
Every tone has a shape to it because it evokes a different emotion. So in discovering the wave conjugations, and we had been held back because mankind had spent its time trying to simplify things instead of looking at the complicated. And maybe it was necessary to keep things simple because life and death was always on the line. But you would want to get to a point where you don't have to be threatening your life every day. And that gives the birth of intelligence. And that birth of intelligence should have led them to recognize that nothing was flat, that there were no straight lines. It should have led them to recognize that, okay, perhaps we're seeing things the wrong way because we are no longer thriving as a race, but we are overcome by disease and we are destroying everything else around us. You can tell when you cause it, when you're having a hard day, when you go to the office and or wherever you work and everybody, you know, gets tense from being around you. Well, that's what the human population has done. It's made it an unsafe work environment.
That's the vibes. That's how people say, did you feel the vibe when he walked in? You know, but what do you feel about, because you talk about the flower of life, and I watch all your, like, the videos I saw last night with Candace T on Sunday or whatever. What I'm curious about, Fibonacci sequence, flower of life, the golden ratio, I know that has to be relevant to what you've discovered, because on the top, when you did the 3-4 dimension thing, it looked like a flower and you were literally putting the objects together. And when I saw them, and I want to actually put the link so people, I know my people are interested in this kind of stuff. So is you literally had the physical objects and you're putting them together to show how, you know, they fit in a way that we had never thought possible. And when you're putting them together, that's the part, Terrence, I was like an hour and 10 minutes in, and then you did the visual, right? And then you showed like the three-dimensional, four-dimensional, and then it popped up on the screen and I got more of an idea. And then that thing in your home that's twisting around with the vortexes and the blah, mm-hmm. Like, where is that? That's insane. That's for real. That's kind of like recreating the atom in a way.
Well, this is what it's doing is redefining the atom. We've always been told that the atom was made up of three balls. And, you know, basically three balls. At the lowest point, it was two balls with hydrogen, with a proton in the center and an electron orbiting it. You know, that was the simplest thing. And then as you move up into the next element, helium, it's supposed to have two protons and now two electrons. And all of these things keep adding on an electron and a proton as they go along. And the isotopes end up being, you know, things that don't have an even number of electrons and protons, you know, which can, it's just a big pot to confuse everyone in.
Completely.
When the real truth of how everything, there's only one thing in the universe. There's only one substance. Now that one substance, it's not 92 separate elements, that one substance is a noble gas that wrapped itself around itself from four different directions. And those four different directions and their constant overtwining and undertwining of each other, those are all noble gases spinning and pushing on each other. So at the end of taking helium and taking hydrogen, taking helium and taking neon, if you imagine both of them spinning in opposition to each other, trying to get away from each other and being forced into each other, well, they're going to cause a pressure condition between them. And this is where the shapes come in. The highest point of pressure, what happens with it? In order to make more water come out of your water hose, you have to squeeze on that, put your thumb over the whole thing, and force more pressure out of it, right?
Yep.
And it flattens out and it becomes like a triangle.
Yep.
Because that's, if an arrow was hitting something, it's the highest point.
Right.
But then on the end of it, on the end of that arrow, it's not meeting any resistance as it's flying through the air. It's meeting very little resistance compared to what's happening in the front. And so it's able to be cooler. And that cold area, guess what it does? It will spread itself out and become that and become what you call a square. And then the balance, so now you have hot on one end and cold on the other end. So red on one end and blue on the other end. And what do you always have in between red and blue? You have the color yellow. And the yellow always expands out as a circle. And that circle is the key of E.
See, now, I mean, you're saying this like, oh, of course.
No, and I'm because, saying.
No, I mean, that is like.
Is the carbon line. It's the hydrogen line. Hydrogen, if you look in the spectrometer, hydrogen is the same color as carbon and the same color as silicon and the same color as cobalt and the same color as rhodium and the same color between yttrium and lutetium.
But this thing that I'm showing on the screen right now, because this is what I watched last night for 2.5 hours, was you showing this, right?
Yeah.
And this, and you're there, and this is what you're talking about right there.
That's a light column. That's a light right. column. But what I'm talking about right now is throw up, DJ, can you share screens with her? No.
I can throw it up, whatever you want. I got it. What do you want?
Look up Walter Russell's periodic table.
Walter what?
Walter Russell's periodic table.
Walter Russell's. Periodic
table in color
table. Is that a race thing
in color?
That was my joke.
This is what someone did in 1926.
I said, was that a race thing? I was being funny, Terrence. I'm a comedian. Come on now.
I don't know. Well, I'm
I said, was that a race thing in color? Oh, come on.
In color. I don't know.
For me, I'm trying to be funny a little bit, a little bit, a little bit. I got it right here.
You gotta stop trying and just be funny.
I am, but I gotta explain
boo.
It. It's right there.
Ooh, you get a boo up. For that one.
It's right there.
That is
it's right
not,
here.
That's not Walter Russell's
oh
periodic table.
Oh, sorry. I put in Walter Russell's. So, Walter. Oh, Walter Russell's periodic table.
In color.
In living color?
In color. Oh. In color.
Okay, here we go. Done. Oh, well, what you know what comes up? Not color. But that's okay.
But if you can do it with, well, DJ, is there, Chris, can you send her that thing?
Look, that's, I mean, like, whatever one, this is that.
That looks whack. It's that one, though, on the far right. That's your far left. That's camp. There we go. That one. And if you could zoom in, in your own mind, at least you could see that the carbon line is a straight line coming. You see the carbon line.
Yeah.
And then you'll see the silicon line right after it. It's in the same exact space you were in. Just look at it.
Yeah, but this is look a the, way better one right here.
Yeah, look in the, look.
This one's way better.
Yeah, that works too. Good, that's perfect. Now go to the hydrogen line for you to look at. You can explain it to the audience next. You got to look at it first.
Oh, yeah, right.
Go to the hydrogen line. Okay. And then look at the carbon line. Carbon is 12 steps after it.
How do you even, like, when did you start discovering
it? I'm going to show you a secret. I'm showing you a secret now.
I love it, but I just want to know, how did you even, I'm going to be an actor, and meanwhile, I'm looking at the hydrogen line, and I'm going to look at the barium and the titanium.
And now look at the, no, hydrogen, the next octave is carbon.
Okay, I'm looking at the sodium, magnesium, aluminum, phosphorus, chlorine.
Now you went too far, because right at silicon. Silicon is the same thing as hydrogen. It's just two octaves above it. And in the previous octave, the space between the hydrogen and the silicon, you're going to see the carbon line.
I'm going to do this.
Do you see it?
I'm going to share the screen.
Yes.
I'm going to do that because my capability to hold the phone apparently is Warren Russell. Periodic table?
Yep.
Periodic table.
Walter Russell. Right. I'm sure some people call him Warren.
I'm lucky. I remember it's Walter. Periodic table in color. And then, okay, I'm going to go to the images. And then, that's the one. There's a lot of options, but I'm going to go to the one I was just on because I think that's the best one.
Well, the only problem with it doesn't have the proper color association. I mean, Chris could email you the proper picture if he's still on.
Yeah, if he's still up. It's so funny.
I don't see him up.
So he's probably is. But I have it, and so I'm going to just do this. I'm going to share the screen. Share screen. Share it. And then application. And then this. And the, here we go. Okay, so this is it. Can you see that?
Yep. I can see it. Go to the far right one. My right.
So I'm just scrolling down. Oh, but wait, you're not.
I can see it.
Can you? Can you see me scrolling?
Yeah. Nothing scrolling. I just see a straight picture, but go to the one on your far right.
Okay.
And you'll see the one that's most illustrated.
Okay. So that is the share screen. That's the screen we are. Being town. This is the light wave. Russell, share.
There, you over there? No, go to the one to the right.
Am I not? This one right here.
Yeah.
Okay.
That one works, even though it's lacking the color. I can still show you the color association.
But can you see me scrolling right now?
Well, I saw you go to that one thing and stop there.
And it stopped?
Yeah.
Oh, that's because I didn't do this. Okay, so.
Yeah, I see other things up instead of the one we pointed
now
to.
Now I'm on it. Can you see me scrolling at all or no?
Yeah, I see you scrolling.
Okay, so now you see my screen. So you want me to go to this guy over here. Where my, see that? That?
Yeah.
Okay, clicking on that. I clicked on that. And now, where is that dude? It's right here. Right?
But there's a bit of a delay for me. I'll probably get in about 5 seconds. But on there, I want you to take a look at the hydrogen line.
Okay.
And you'll see those. You'll see hydrogen there.
I'm on it. I see. Cadmium, boron, carbon, oxygen, fluorine, magnesium, aluminum.
No, go backwards. Go backwards. Go backwards.
Go.
Go backwards from the sodium.
Here's the picture of the dude.
Yeah, no, go backwards from sodium. You're going to hit neon. Will be the first noble gas you're going to hit. It'll be neon, then it'll be fluorine, which is a minus one. Then it's going to be
I got fluorine. I see the fluorine.
Okay, that's a minus one. And then you have a minus two of
oxygen. I see neon. Yep.
Right? And neon is a noble gas. Now look all the way over. Walk your way through that whole octave. It'll see it balance out with carbon. Carbon is the middle line between the lithium and the fluorine, which are both plus ones.
Yep, chlorine, potassium, calcium, titanium.
Now you're going back down again. Now, if you'll notice, though, that
carbon right there.
There's your carbon.
Yeah.
The carbon has the same exact color as the hydrogen, and it has the same exact color as the phosphorus. It's on the same line. It has the same exact color as the cobalt. It's the color yellow. It's always going
Here we go. Carbon. Can you see what I'm scrolling on? Because I've never done this before.
No, I can't see what you're scrolling on, but I know the chart decently.
I know, but can you guys see? Can you see? Can you see what I'm scrolling on?
No, but you're
I'm sharing. I've never done the share screen before. So I'm trying to do that. I mean, it would help if you guys let me know that it's working. Because I just added it to the screen. Where now? Okay. Someone said, where does AG and AU elements play into this? Someone just
where
asked
does
that.
Argon and aluminum play into this?
Yeah.
Where does gold, AG? All of those things are part of isotopes. Well, the aluminum is a plus three. And it sits right within the silicone octave, you know. But when you're talking about gold, you're into the lutetium or the yttrium octave, depending on which one you allow to be the carbon line. They're all the results of the pressure that's happening between the noble gases. The noble gases being the helium, the neon, the argon, I think it's the xenon next, or as Walter called it, titan.
Okay, Terrence, someone would love to know if you're aware of physicist Dr. Ron Mellett, who invented a time machine and whose story was bought by Spike Lee. This is in the chat room. He's fascinated, and this dude is, his brain is crazy brilliant, and that was his question to you, because he wants to know about, you know, physicist who invented a time machine and whose story was Spike Lee bought the story, so he wants to know about the
let me share the ideas concerning the time machine. Every atom or waveform in this universe is connected to every other atom or waveform in this universe. Everything is expanding.
Right.
Every single interaction is expanding at a speed that they don't know, whether it's half the speed of light or near the speed of light. Everything is expanding.
Yep.
So in order to move one atom back to where it was 2 seconds ago, you have to move every single atom or waveform back to where it was 2 seconds ago. And therefore, you have to move every connected universe back to where it was 2 seconds ago. It will take more than all the combined energy of all of the multiverses together to move 1 second, one atom behind.
So can we use this free humanity? Like, can we use, what you're discovering right now, which I know you're trying to dumb it down, but ultimately the all this hydrogen and whatnot, like that's the first time people have even looked at or seen, not all people, but.
Well, this was the point I wanted to make with the hydrogen. I'm saying the hydrogen is the color yellow. The plus one, which would have been the lithium, is basically, it's that violet or indigo. And the plus two is the red, the beryllium, the beryllium is that red. The orange becomes the boron. The hydrogen becomes the yellow. The minus three, the natural mate of the plus three of the boron, becomes green. The next one becomes blue, and the next one becomes the violet. So, and that's how the entire periodic table works. So you can now mix elements the same way you are able to mix color. You know what colors work together. Those are the things that this technology allows. But not only that, it also shows you their shape and how they arrange themselves. So now we can point lasers in the proper direction and utilize. It's one thing to grab a woman by her baby finger, but to have her hand and her elbow, and to have your hand by her cheek, all of those things mean a greater amount of comfort and easier to be comfortable around, to have that kind of access. And that's what this allows us. Before, we were poking people. We were poking at science with sticks, with 10-foot long sticks that were uncomfortable. Now we're hands-on with the geometry, and it's an invisible geometry that controls all the other geometry. This is where electricity lives. So it's like having a party in Ibiza instead of having a party in Alaska. The light and electricity is going to show up there. You know, the beautiful people are going to show up at the party in Ibiza and stay there. And the light loves these shapes because this is where electricity is. This is where they are formed. And so they're always going to stay home and enjoy their rooms. And so now it's also opened up the door. Instead of there just being two poles, you know, just being able to reach somebody by talking to their friend or talking to, you know, them through some chat, you know, now you've got four or five close family members. Oh, this is a brother, this is, and now you have a better opportunity of reaching their heart and them being a willing participant.
And that's people that are actually open and seeking, which are very few people I find in the universe that are wanting to learn rather than be conditioned and programmed. And ultimately, I guess one of my questions to you is, you know, do you feel like this invention that you uncovered, discovered, tapped
discovery
into?
It's just, right? I'm a gardener that was working in the field.
And I love the visual of the gardener, because you're the gardener that, you know, is ultimately tapping into something huge. And most people, when you let them know the secret or you out it, they will be anything but accepting, because it means change. It means, you know, changing the format of their thought patterns and what they're used to. And until people become open and aware of people like you that are willing to give information and they don't distrust it, and they just go, okay. So one of the questions was, do you have a proof of concept? Which, by the way, he does. If you go to his YouTube channel, which I was looking up Terrence Howard and nothing came up. So your YouTube channel is not Terrence Howard. It's THP. What is it?
T, the YouTube DJ in them now. It's THP.
Yeah, that's what I thought. So it's
Terrence Howard.
Right, exactly. Project. Terrence Howard Project. So that's where I finally found you, because when you said you were going to out it at your, you know, the Hollywood star thing, and that was all about, like, I was so excited to hear about it.
Person working with DJ.
I wanted to see and hear about that. And so that wasn't that hard to uncover, because, you know, I researched, and that's what people do here. But Ron Mallett created essentially a fax time machine where he can send messages via neurons with upward and down spins.
Sending messages. Well, yeah. You've got to remember, everything is being sent. So everything that's sent from here has an equal and opposite that's immediately set up in the natural balance of thing that's coming in the same direction. That's happening. That's what they consider to be entanglement and all of those things.
Right.
Everything is interacting on multiple levels. And when one action occurs, there's
reaction.
There's so many reactions. Mm-hmm. And those reactions, this isn't the first reaction. So they're already prepared for it. There's a previous wave for it. But my wife just got home.
Yeah, and I get it. And the fact that you were here, the fact that you were here is really, for me, was probably highlight of my week, if not month. And I'm telling you that now that I have your email, I might ask you to come on when people are awake. And by awake, I mean awake and awake. Because
it's all about becoming aware. You should read the book. Read the book.
Oh no! What I want you to do is when I have you on and people are there live, like during the day, I'm going to put the link to your book, because it's free, and I love what you said. The truth. When you're really sharing the truth, it's free. And his book, one. What is it? 1 + 1 is fucking 8. Is that what it's called? 1 + 1 isn't 2. Anyway, the point.
It's 1 × 1. It's the 1 × 1. It's the consideration.
Yes.
All right. Take care. It's a pleasure.
Hey, Terrence. Nice to meet you. Thanks for coming on the show.
All right. Enjoy.
And we'll talk soon. I appreciate you being here. Tell your wife thanks for sharing.
Yeah. I'm trying to figure out how to.
I know it's difficult to figure out how to, like, let go or hang up. So how cool was that? Oh.